Praise God.
Well, good afternoon, champions.
Praise God. Good to see all of you here today. What a wonderful time we're having in the presence of God. And by the way, thank you so much for your prayers. God has healed me in Jesus' name. Last week I couldn't make it. All of a sudden, you know, I got sick. But praise the Lord that God has healed. And that's what the power of God is. And, you know, He's more than wonderful. Amen. Well, as we get closer to Christmas, how many are excited? Yeah. Have you finished your shopping yet? All right, well, it's only one more week left. And we are reminded about the reason for the season, as we've been hearing from the songs and the special numbers that we have. The season is really about the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. And more than 2,000 years ago, Jesus was born in a manger, and there were three wise men who learned about Christ and went to seek Him. So although this may be a long time ago, and you may say, well, that's 2,000 years ago already, but I want you to know that we can still learn some truths today about the story of the three wise men. So today, we're going to be looking at the scripture, the passage in the Gospel of Matthew. We're going to read from Matthew chapter 2, verse 1 to 12, talking about the three wise men. Here's what the Bible says. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." Verse 3, when King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. In Bethlehem, in Judea, they replied, for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them in the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him. After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. So let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this wonderful time that we have in your presence. And we pray now, Lord, that we open our hearts and our minds to you. May your Holy Spirit illuminate your word, that it will bring transformation in our lives so that we can apply it in our daily life. And so, Lord, we pray, have your way right now, and let your anointing rest upon us that we may understand your word. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, Matthew introduces Jesus through the Magi. Magi were from a Median tribe who believed in a Persian religion. In other words, they were pagans. They were likely astrologers who believed God showed signs in heaven. And there was actually no number recorded in the scripture. We just assumed there were three because there were three gifts. So traditionally, we have talked about and we have learned that it was the three wise men. You know, what makes us wonder, what if it were the three wise women? What would have been different if there were the three wise women? You know what they said? They said that they would have probably asked directions before going to Jerusalem. They would have probably arrived on time to even help deliver the baby. They would have cleaned the stable and brought some practical gifts, like maybe, you know, from Toys R Us, like baby wipes and diapers, and maybe even brought some food, you know, and have a party right there. And there would have been peace on earth. Amen. Well, friends, you know, anyway, they had traveled over miles and miles and miles of desert, leading a caravan of servants and supplies. And, you know, when they traveled that far, they would have had servants. They would have had a lot of supplies. So it would have been a whole caravan. And they were wealthy noblemen, astrologers and advisors of the court in the east. And their journey had begun weeks ago, when they had identified a brilliant, shining star in heaven. And it is the kind that they believed that would have been significant for maybe the birth of a great prophet or a warrior or maybe even a king. And so they left their homes and journeyed for weeks following the star until they finally reached Jerusalem, which is the heart and center of Israel. King Herod and his ministers, you know, wanted to find out what these three wise men had to discuss. And so they met him in his king's chamber. And when they met the three wise men, to his surprise, you know, because he wanted to know why they were there and coming from the east. And to his surprise, he finds out that they came looking for the king of the Jews, because they wanted to worship him. And of course that disturbed him, and he called the wise men secretly and sent them to Bethlehem to report back to him if this was really true. So the wise men went and followed the star to personally meet Jesus. And I believe, friends, today that this is more than just a story to entertain us. I believe that there is some truths that we can find to teach us today about seeking Christ. And today we're going to learn some truths about what it means to seek the Lord Jesus Christ. And we learn from the story of the three wise men. So the first thing that we see, the first truth that we see in the scripture is this, that God makes a way for us to seek Him. God makes a way for us to seek Him. We see God used the star to reach a pagan Gentile astrologers in order to bring them to Christ. Now think about that. The Bible says, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who has been born king of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him. See, the wise men were on a mission to find the newborn king of the Jews and worship him. But here's the important truth that we find about, or we learn about God. That God will make a way to reach every person, no matter how far they are from Him. Amen? Amen? Amen. You see, these wise men were pagan Gentiles and not Jews who had come seeking the King of the Jews. The Jews believed, by the way, that the Messiah, who was promised to deliver them from their sins and to protect them from their oppressors, was only promised for the Jews and not to the Gentiles. Yet the wise men were Gentiles and they were drawn to God. They felt drawn to Him. They did not even have the same religion as the Jews. In fact, they were Magi, which was a combination of a learned scientist with cultic astrology. And they knew science as well as magic. They were magician astrologers. And these were practices that God specifically forbid for His people. So what does this tell us? It tells us that God never abandons anyone. Nobody is too far away from the Lord that He cannot reach them. Friends, sometimes we feel that there are people in our lives, maybe people that we know, maybe a relative, maybe a friend or office mate, maybe we have people that we know that we feel that they're just too far away from God and they will never find Christ.
Friends, if he can use an astronomical event like a shining star to reach pagan astrologers, then he can use anything at any time to lead people to Christ.
Amen.
Amen. The best way to reach astrologers was, of course, use the star. Because they can relate to them. God knew the best thing to reach them, and he led them to Christ. What did God do? Let me just ask you a question today, and something that we can ponder on. What did God do in your life to get your attention so that you will be led to Christ? Perhaps maybe a financial issue, or maybe a friend who brought you, maybe a tragedy or a crisis, maybe a sickness. You know, I know what happened in my life. I was drawn to the Lord, and I felt that I was being that God was getting my attention. It was a business failure to me. It was that. It was something that, you know, happened in my life, and that because of that, I felt that God drew my attention, and I had to listen to God, and I drew close to God. And since then, of course, I've walked with him over those years. What about you? What did God do in your life that brought your attention to God? You see, we all didn't know Christ. We all didn't know we were supposed to seek him. I don't know if you knew that. We weren't all raised in a Bible-believing church. In fact, I was born in a Catholic church, and we were religious people. Not overly religious, but we were religious. We went every Sunday. You know, we prayed when we needed to pray. We went the extra mile, and, you know, the Easter and the Christmas. And the other days that maybe we had to go. And so we were religious, and I grew up in that. But I didn't know I was supposed to seek him. I didn't know him personally. I didn't have a personal encounter with God. I just went with my parents. And when I grew up, I just went because it was just something I did every time. So we didn't know God. We didn't know we had to seek him. In fact, we didn't even know Churchianese. You know Churchianese? It's the church language. You know, only church people will understand. You know what I mean? When we have this Churchianese, our church language, that only we people in the church understand. Like, for example, when you say, "Oh, I received the fire of God." Wow, fire of God. Imagine a person outside of the church, he has the fire of God. I mean, something came up on him. Did you call the fireman maybe to put out the fire or something? You know, or someone will say, "Well, you know, I received the blood of Jesus all over me." Oh, blood of Jesus? Ew, all over you? Can you imagine the blood pouring all over you? I mean, you know, these are churches. This is language that we understand. But people outside of the church don't know what that means. You know, being saved. What does that mean, being saved? You mean saving money or whatever? What's being saved? You see, so these are Church of the East language that we have. And we didn't know you're supposed to have that. They don't, you know, that's the way people are who are away from the Lord. They don't know that. They don't know they need the Lord.
Yes.
And you know what? It's not their fault. They didn't have the foundation. They weren't raised that way. They don't know that they are supposed to seek him. And so God comes to us in ways that we can understand. He makes it relevant to us where we are at. That is why God came in the flesh. And we were singing about that he is Emmanuel, God with us, so that he could be like one of us. You know, to talk to the people in their language, to eat with them, to see their culture in their eyes and through their eyes, so that he could tell us our need for him and to seek him out. Having said that, friends, in the same way, God expects us to do the same for people. To reach them in whatever means we can, to reach people in a language they understand in order to bring them to Christ. Then we would do whatever it takes. Of course, he doesn't want us to compromise our integrity and violate his commandments. Of course, he doesn't want us to do that. But he expects us also to go out of our way to reach people for Christ. To reach someone and lead them to Christ. See, this is what I love about our sharing the joy of Christmas. I love this because as I was watching on the screen, I was looking at what you guys have been doing all over, and whether you are offering coffee, you know, or singing in the nursing home, or feeding the homeless, you are doing something and you're bringing Christ to them.
Amen.
And that through our acts of kindness, we are able to share Christ and the joy of Christmas. And that's what it's really all about. And I really love this family because we're going out there and making a difference in the people's lives. So it's not just about us having presentations. Of course, I love the way we do presentations. We've got a lot of talented people here. We could do a lot of, presentation. We've been doing that. We do, a lot of drama and creative arts. We gather the people and we come here. And it's just only those that we can invite to come here. It's only within these four walls. But I believe that God wants us to go beyond these four walls and let Him be known to our community. And that's what the joy, this sharing the joy of Christmas is all about. And so praise God that we're out there demonstrating who Christ is. And bringing it to them that they can relate. And that's the way God is. Now I want you to think for a moment. Think of someone that is so far from the Lord. Someone that you know, I want you to know this, that God still loves that person and is still working on this person's life to bring them to Christ.
Amen.
And God is using you and is using me in the areas of this person's life that God is at work. And He wants us to partner with Him to bring that person to Christ.
Amen.
That's what God is doing. The second truth that we learn from this is not only that God makes a way to reach people to Christ, but God brings us to a deeper knowledge of Christ. He brings us to a deeper knowledge of Christ. The second truth that we find in this scripture, it teaches us about God, that He wants us to diligently seek Him and to know Him. Friends, it's not enough to just know about Christ. We must seek out a personal encounter and relationship with Him. Amen? You see, the truth is, we can have all of the knowledge of the Bible, we can follow God's commandments, and still miss what the Christian faith is all about. Seeking Christ until we find Him and get to know Him. It's not just about learning about Him. I mean, we could just stay home and read about Jesus. But why do we come here? Because we want a personal encounter with Him where we worship Him. We come together and we worship where He is, and we're able to come together and learn more from Him. See, friend, the truth is we can do all of that. You see, but these Gentile pagan astrologers, with only partial information about a Jewish Messiah, set off on a journey of faith to find Christ, the King of the Jews. It wasn't even their king. But they went on a journey of faith for miles. The journey to Bethlehem cost them time. It cost them money. It cost them their precious gifts. But friends, they had faith. And made an effort to seek out the Christ child despite the inconvenience. For those of you that have gone with us to Israel, you know how hard it is to be walking on those rocky ground. They didn't have cars. They didn't have taxi. They didn't have Uber. They didn't have all these means of transportation. They walked for miles and miles. What? Just to meet Christ, to have a personal encounter with Him. Let me ask you a question. Are we willing to be inconvenienced to go and seek Christ? Are we willing to, go through maybe a little bit of rain, a little bit of snow, as to be able to find him. Friends, on the other hand, we see this religious community, the Jewish community in Jerusalem. These people knew their God through the Holy Scriptures. They did all of the ritual, they did all of the commandments, yet when the wise men showed up, Herod and these religious leaders were even shocked to find out that the Messiah had already been born. In fact, they were disturbed, the Bible says, or troubled upon hearing the news. They had no clue that the King of the Jews, their King, their Messiah, was already born. You know, it had to take some Gentiles, astrologers, pagans, to tell them about the Messiah. What a shame. What a shame. You know, you can imagine, that's really bad news. How bad that was. Rather than be overjoyed at the good news that the Messiah had come, in fact, what happened to them, they were worried and probably even skeptical and did nothing about it. You know, unlike the wise men who have traveled for hundreds of miles to worship the Christ, the religious leaders didn't do anything. You know, and yet they were closer. They were only 6 miles or so away, and they could have just walked there. It would have been closer to Bethlehem from Jerusalem than these wise men from the east. And yet, we don't find in Scripture that any one of them went. They had to tell the wise men to go to Bethlehem and do this. And none of the religious leaders, none of the religious Jewish community even went to find and see Christ. See, friends, isn't that interesting? That even those that are just close by didn't even go? Isn't that interesting? Is that the reality of the church? That's really the reality. Then you know a church could have an event and maybe have a time of worshiping the Lord, maybe prayer, or maybe a time of infilling of the Holy Spirit, or a time of worship celebration. And the church could have that. And people from everywhere could be coming, traveling miles to get there, and yet people just around the corner can't make it. Think about that. Isn't that what happens sometimes? You know, you have a prayer meeting or a time where you can actually come in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, a time where you can celebrate together and worship Him. And then people would come from everywhere, and yet those that are close can't even come and make it. Maybe tells us a little bit about where our heart is. King Herod even had to send the wise men off to find Jesus so they can report back to him. You wonder why they wouldn't go and seek him. You know what? Perhaps they were more concerned about their rituals, their laws, than they were about a relationship with God. Sometimes that's what we do. We just go through the motions of coming, but then is it really that, or is it a relationship with Christ? Friends, we can have a knowledge of the Bible, and we can have even religious convictions, or we can even live out God's commands to the letter and still miss the point. God is seeking a relationship with us through His Son, Jesus Christ. That's what the Lord wants. He wants a personal encounter with us through Jesus Christ, and He wants us to seek Him. It's not just about hearing about Him. It's not about knowing that God is around. It's about seeking Him. See, what we find out is that when we seek Him, we will find Him. Jesus once said, He said, "Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened to you." The author of Hebrews wrote this, and he said this in Hebrews 11, verse 6. "And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him." See, that's what it's about. That we must believe that He actually exists. It's impossible that we can please God without faith. And that is that faith of believing that He exists, that He is Him that we are coming to. That when we come to a worship celebration, it's by faith that we're believing that God's presence is there. That when we're coming in, we're believing God that He will speak to us, that God will touch us, that the Spirit of God will move upon us. And that's by faith. And we travel and we go from different places and we come because we want a personal encounter with Him. Amen? And when we find Him, meaning having a relationship with God through Christ, everything else falls into place.
That's right.
When we start to have that relationship with Christ, you see, the Magi were rewarded for their journey of faith to meet Christ. They were rewarded. They were changed. They were transformed. Friends, the same way when we come to church, when we live good lives, is it because our primary focus is seeking Christ, to search for Him and to try to draw closer and nearer to Him? Or are we like religious leaders in Jesus' day who think that doing our religious duty is enough? Following God's commandment, being at church, maybe even knowing the Bible very well, but really having no personal encounter with Him. May this season be a time where we can say, God, I want a fresh encounter with You.
Amen.
Or what that really means of Christmas. I celebrate Christmas every year, but Lord, may this Christmas be different.
Yes.
May not just be a routine of everything, of religious activities, of the same thing over and over. May there be a fresh encounter with You. You see, friends, God wants us to encounter Him in a fresh way. Amen? The third thing, the third truth that we see is we need to worship Christ. We need to worship Christ. See, wise men offered valuable gifts. The question is, what do we offer to God? Worship is not an option with Jesus. We need to worship Him because He is our God. He is our Lord. He is our Savior. And you know, once the wise men reached Jesus, it says that the first thing that they did was worship. Just like the shepherds who, when they learned about Jesus, when they went to see Him, and when they have seen Him, they began to sing praises to Him and worship before God. It says of the Magi, in Matthew 2, verse 11, as we read a while ago, on coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped Him. Then they opened their treasures and presented Him with gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. See, they bowed down and worshiped. See, one expression of worship is to bow low before another. It symbolizes one's submission to the other as having authority over them. And that's why you'll find in some cultures that they bow before a person, a dignitary, a person of influence, a person of authority. They bow. Why? It is a sign of submission to the other person. And that is why today we say we must receive Jesus as our Lord. Is like letting our attitude bow before Him because He is in control and we submit ourselves to Him.
Amen.
It's interesting though that sometimes we could bow our heads in prayer, but our heart and our attitude does not submit to Him. It's sad that we could bow our head in prayer, but our attitude and our heart does not submit to Him. And what God wants is that we bow before Him and we need to worship Him. Anyway, the three wise men worshiped Christ and presented three gifts as an offering. Remember that to worship also means offering. That's also what it means. And actually, friends, when we come into the presence of Christ, an offering. You know, sometimes we get so hung up on, you know, the tithes and offerings, and there's a debate whether we should even give our tithes. But the reality or the truth is that when we come into the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, we cannot come empty-handed. We come to the King of Kings. We come with an offering. Friends, we don't come empty-handed. It's like this. It's like going to a birthday party. And you're invited to a birthday party, and you go there, and you don't even bring a gift. You know, it's as if, hey, it's understood. I just come, I'll just eat and enjoy, but don't expect me to bring a gift. You know people like that? You know, I'll just come in. Some of you even probably gate crash. And then we'll just come, just enjoy it, have everything, but never even bring anything. Not even being sensitive at times that, you know, maybe your plate is $100 a plate. And they never even brought anything. Think about that. Isn't that ridiculous? See, we worship when we give our offering. And we worship by offering that which is valuable to us. The gifts which the Magi brought were very valuable because Christ deserved a gift worthy of a king. If you were invited by the Prime Minister Trudeau into his private birthday party, imagine. You were invited by the Prime Minister himself to attend his private birthday party. I'm sure you wouldn't go to the dollar store and get a mug and maybe use a recycled gift wrap and a gift bag. You wouldn't do that. I'm sure you would try to come up with something nice to bring. Because he's a prime minister worthy to bring something of value. How much more the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords that we have been portraying here, that he's so wonderful. How much more? See, the first gift that they brought, of course, is gold. And that is a treasure deserving of a king. So gold. And the frankincense and myrrh were very expensive because they were imported from Arabia. That's far. And of course, the frankincense was it was an extract from a bark of a tree that when you burn it, it has a fragrant scent. And it was actually used for sacrificial worship. When you worship, they would burn this frankincense and it would be symbolizing the divinity of Christ. And the myrrh was extracted from a shrub that was used as an embalming oil to prepare a body for burial. And in fact, myrrh was used to embalm Jesus when he died. It was a gift symbolizing the preservation of life after death. It was a gift for a Savior who died for us all. You know what King David said? He said in 2 Samuel 24:24, I will not offer to my God burnt offerings that cost me nothing. See, each of these gifts that the wise men brought were very valuable to them. It cost them something. And that's what we need to do when we give our offering. Worship should cost us something. Like David who said, I wouldn't want to, you know, offer something to my God that doesn't cost me anything. I don't want to give him something to just free. It want to cost me something. See, this Christmas, we will be receiving and giving gifts. What do we bring and offer Christ, which is costly to us? You know, there's a beautiful song that sometime in the Christmas season says, what can I give to the King? Right, you know, a king was everything. What can you give? Now, what can you give to the King who has everything? See, what do we lay at his feet? See, probably the most, more than the gifts that we can offer, probably the best gift that we can give, best offering is we can give to the Lord is our lives. Amen? Amen. Romans 12 verse 1, Paul says it this way. He said, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. You want to worship the Lord? Give Him your life. You want a true worship before God? It's not just money or things that we can give. It is our life. Live lives pleasing to Him would be a worship before God.
Amen.
Amen. The way or the time to please God is now when you are a living sacrifice, not when you're dead. There's nothing to offer the Lord anymore when you're gone. See, what will bring praises to the Lord, what will worship Him, is while you're alive, present yourself as a sacrifice before the Lord, living holy before Him.
Amen.
Living a life pleasing to Him. That's why it's called a living sacrifice, because it's not easy. It is a sacrifice to live pleasing to God. Amen? It's not easy. To every day be conscious about the fact that I have to live my life pleasing Him. You know, whether I'm at work or maybe at home or whenever I'm tempted by circumstances around me, I still need to live for God to please Him. That's a sacrifice. A living sacrifice. That we, our lives will be pleasing to God. That is our worship. When our lives are submitted to Him, friends, when you have submitted your life, when your life is offered to Him, offering material things, it's not a burden, it's a joy. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
When your life is already fully submitted to Him, anything else you offer is just a joy. Not a burden. It becomes a burden when our lives are not even submitted to Him. It will be a burden to give anything. But when your life is fully submitted, you can give anything and it's a joy. Amen? Lastly, are you still with me?
Yes.
Praise God. Lastly, here's another truth. We need to obey God's direction. We need to obey God's direction. The wise men obeyed God's direction by not returning to Herod. Did you agree? See, Matthew 2:12, we see there, and having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. See, they must have experienced Christ in a powerful way. That their lives were never the same. They were changed. They were transformed. When they got into the presence of Christ, they were transformed to the point that they were willing to disobey King Herod. Imagine that. King Herod told them to go and report back to him. And little did they know that King Herod had another plan, which is to kill the King of Jews, to kill the baby Jesus. But they didn't know that. But then what happened to them is that they had a powerful encounter with Him, so much so that things changed in their life, and that they were open to God, that God would speak to them, and they would even disobey King Herod and risk their life. Why? Because they had an encounter with Christ. It changed them. They were willing to obey God's direction rather than men. They were willing to do that. They experienced Christ in a powerful way. Even though the wise men had found Christ's child and had worshipped Him, they weren't done. They weren't finished yet. You know, it wasn't like this, like, okay, I'm done. I've done my duty. I've come already. I've seen the King. You know, I'm glad that it's over. Let's go back to regular life. Just the normal routine. It wasn't that way. You see, these wise men, when they came, you know, they were seeking God, and it didn't end with meeting Christ. They continued to be led by God. They were drawn to Him, and when they saw Him, it wasn't the end of it. It wasn't the end of their relationship. In fact, that was the beginning, and they were willing to listen to God and continue on in their life. See, friends, when you come to know Christ, that's not the end of it. It's not the end when you meet Christ. It's the beginning of your life.
Yeah.
then you need to continue to listen and to obey God's will in your life. What brought you to Him, to seek Him, He wants to continue to have that relationship with you as you move further in your journey with Him. See, God gave them a message in a dream. They recognized this dream as a message from God, and they obeyed. They didn't go back and tell Herod. Friends, there is never a point, and here's the key. There is never a point in our lives when we can say that we have arrived, that we have figured out this Christian life. There's never a time. Because every single day, it's just a day that we're getting closer to knowing Him more. Every day we're just maturing in our walk with God, because the goal is to be conformed to His image. And every day as sons in the house, we just keep growing and growing to become more like Him. And so we've never arrived. If you have already arrived, you'll be dead today. You'll be gone. You're perfect. And if you're perfect, God can't use you anymore. You're going to be in heaven now. How many are perfect? All right. You see, friends, God wants to use us, and just every single day, we got to keep obeying Him and growing in our walk with God. Just because we have sought Christ and found Him doesn't mean that we are at the end of our journey. We need to seek Him. We need to worship Him. But these aren't a one-time event. It's not only one time. We must continue to be led by Him and to do His will. It may not be even in a dream, you know, but God still speaks to us in other ways, such as maybe through Scripture, maybe through prayer, and maybe leading us away from danger and to stay focused on His plan and His will for our lives. Let me ask you today, what place are you in at today? Are you the one far from God that is hearing the calling to come and seek Him? Remember, God continues to seek you no matter what, where you come from, and no matter what your background is. It doesn't matter. God is still seeking you. And if you're here, it's a very good place to begin your journey. This is the place. This is the time. And now is the day of salvation. This is the time to seek Him. God promises you that if you seek Him, you will find Him and be rewarded for your journey of faith. Or are you a seeker who has begun your journey because God has not, who began your journey to personally meet Christ, to begin a relationship with God? Maybe you've begun that journey, but don't give up on the journey, because God has not given up on you. You know how it is, sometimes we begin the journey with the Lord, and then circumstances come. Sometimes they're very difficult, and sometimes people quit in the journey. They give up. You know, in pastoring for more than 25 years, I've been seeing people, sometimes there's this situation when people go through difficulty, the first thing they give up is their relationship with God. When they have difficulties and challenges, the first thing that they give up is their life group. They give up coming to the worship celebration. They give up going to prayer. They give up reading the Word of God. They give up in the relationship thinking that it's going to be better. Actually, when we go through difficulties, when we go to challenges, it's not the time to go away from God. That's the time to run to God. Amen. And everybody said,
Amen.
The time to run to God, to obey Him in your life. You see, friends, don't give up on the relationship with Him on your journey. No matter how difficult it gets, God wants to continue walking with you. He's not giving up on you, so don't give up on Him. Amen? Tell the person beside you, don't give up. You know why I say that? Because sometimes we don't even know what people are going through. They may look good on the outside. You know, we see people having Merry Christmas, but deep inside they're having problems. They have problems in the home, their financial issue, maybe, you know, work issue, whatever. and they're going through difficulties in their life, and you never know. Friends, I say, don't give up your relationship now. The third is, are you a worshiper of Christ? What have you offered Him? I can tell you what He wants the most. It's not your journey. It's not your money. It's not even your time. God likes you to give those, but the most important thing, what He really wants, is you, all of you, every part of you. That you will give to Him all of who you are. That you will love Him with all of your heart, your mind, soul, and strength. Amen? You receive that today? Amen? That we can learn from this story that God will always make a way. There is nobody who's too far away from God. Now you could be here today and you may say, well, I've done so many crazy things. I'm just so far away from God. I don't think God would love me. I want you to know today that God is still seeking you and is making a way for you. Amen. And that God wants us to worship Him, to come before Him. And He wants us to be able to continue to obey Him in our life. And so today, let us draw close to Him. And let's offer our lives back to Him. Amen? Amen. Let's all stand as we worship together.